Hello and welcome to Dateline London. President Trump's travel ban ruled out by a court. Mr. Trump responds with, see you in court. Is he now the litigant in chief? And Russian intervention in Libya, another tactical victory for Putin. My guests today are Abdul Bari Atwan, who is a writer and broadcaster on Arab Affairs, Stephanie Baker of Bloomberg News, Yasmin Alibi Brown, the author and commentator, and Vincent Mugombe, who's an African commentator. Very good to see you. While President Trump's own nominee to the US Supreme Court was said to have criticized the president over Mr. Trump's attitude to judges, Trump talked of so-called judges. It follows the court decision to rule out the president's travel ban on people from mostly Muslim countries and further bitterness between the president and some in Congress. Are these teething troubles or a sign of how the next 4 years are likely to be in Washington, with the president attacking the pillars of the US Constitution? I mean, where do you think we are now in this, actually, Stephanie?
Well, I think, look, what happened this week is reflective of the fact that Trump clearly has a somewhat hazy view of the Constitution and separation of powers and the checks and balances that are the hallmarks of the U.S. political system. Now, the appeals court judges sent a very strong message to him saying you cannot invoke national security concerns to do basically whatever you want. Now, are these teething problems? To some extent, I think there's some of that going on. You know, remember when he issued the executive order on immigration, he didn't have key appointments in place, Rex Tillerson as Secretary of State, Jeff Sessions as Attorney General. And the fact that he's now said that he's considering rewriting the order and making it more narrow reflects the fact that, or suggests to me, that Jeff Sessions has basically told him, this is too risky. Perhaps you need to dial this back if you really want to make sure to not lose this. But I think that the hallmarks of the Trump presidency seem pretty clear now. And people who think that he's going to pivot and become more presidential in his style and manner are going to be left disappointed. His style is to attack personally people on Twitter, judges, corporate executives. And you know, there's a real risk to that going forward. Not only is he tying himself very personally to policy initiatives such as the immigration order that seem destined to fail, he can't distance himself from it or blame other advisors, but he's also, with the attacks on the judges in his tweets, seems to be parking blame at their feet for any possible future terrorist attack, which I think is very, very dangerous going forward. No one should be surprised that this is how he's carrying himself out. You know, this is how he ran his business for years. He was extremely combative, confrontational, and extremely litigious as well. So I don't think this is going to change. This is the style will remain the same. He may dial back and adopt more moderate positions, like we've seen him do so far on certain foreign policy issues, supporting One China, Israel, and so forth. But I don't think you're going to see a different kind of Trump emerge.
Barry, what do you think of it? How do you think this has gone down in many Arab countries? I mean, it's only certain countries that have been singled out here.
You know, the man is barely 3 weeks in power, and he is creating a lot of problems everywhere. First, seven Muslim countries. It is pure racism. And, you know, he picked the countries who never exported terrorism to that part of the world, honestly, you know. And it's amazing. Only six terrorist attacks actually happened in the United States from those immigrants living in the United States. The second thing is, you know, contradiction. First, he wanted Saudi Arabia and Gulf State to pay for the protection, American protection. Now he's phoning them saying, okay, come with me and fight Iran. You know, he wants to dismantle that nuclear deal.
Is that bit going down quite well in Saudi Arabia and elsewhere?
Yes,
because,
Saudi, yes.
The Saudis are absolutely focused on Iran. That's their number one foreign policy priority.
He knows these Gulf States countries are very vulnerable and they are scared. And they were always protected by United States. Now, Obama actually said, look, you have to change your strategy. You have to depend on yourself. You have to talk to Iran. You have to solve your problem by talking, you know, because, you know, you cannot have easy ride, as he say, you know, in the Atlantic interview, which is well known. So I believe, you know, now Trump is working to the hands and to the agendas of ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and other...
Why do you say that?
Why say that? Because simply now, you know, all the Muslims feel, you know, vulnerable, and they believe this man actually is coming to attack Muslims, to hate Muslims, to create wars in that part of the world. Now he unifying the Shia and the Sunni against the United States. You know, there was a division before him. You know, for example, terrorism used to be a Sunni trademark. Now he is actually saying Iran is a terrorist state. So for the first time, he managed to unify the Muslim terrorists and the Shia terrorists and the Sunni terrorists, or to mobilize all the Muslim worlds against the United States. Is this a wise policy?
Mm. Well, I will not tell you what I think of Trump. I'll tell you what Africans think about Trump and Ugandans, for example. I've had many say that he seems to have some African blood running. Mm. I don't mean the normal Africa. Mm. I don't mean the cultures of Africa. Mm. I mean that club of dictators in Africa. There's been recently a Facebook sort of video that went viral. Trump here, Idi Amin here. You needed to have listened to how Idi Amin used to speak. You know, that egotistic, I am the greatest man on the earth. God is the one who put me here. This and that, you know, I'm very good. Somebody actually, there was an American satirical program on, this is the one on CNN or somewhere, where they did that comparison between Trump and African dictators. Put Idi Amin, put Mugabe, put everything. And it was so marked for me, very, very interesting when I saw the type of comparison. This man is a joke.
But he's not a joke. He's elected as president of the United States. No. Nobody has seriously challenged his legitimacy.
No, I'm saying he's a joke because I know he may have been elected by American people, but what he's doing and how he's doing it. And I can tell you that personally, I believe that all the things that he's been saying, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Being an Amin type of person, he will not even do those things. I mean, look at what is happening with the ban. I'm very sure very soon he will discover that he can't do it. And he's going to find a way of retracting that.
For example, for example, I'm following the ISIS on the social media. You cannot imagine they are celebrating what Trump is saying. They said, you know, look, this is the American. This is the people. We told you they hate us as a Muslims, but you never believed us. So now this is the proof.
But I think both of you have raised two really important points. And I do agree with you. It's not just terrorists coming together. There was a time, do you remember, in the late 70s and early 80s, when America was hated in so many parts of the world, when they were burning the flags, and they were, you know, kidnapping Americans and so on. He's taking America back to that place where Americans will not be safe in the world. And because it's not just terrorism, all Muslims of whatever hue are feeling that, hey, my goodness, we are the next Jews, if you like, of the century and all of that. But you are so right. Because what Idi Amin, you know, the thing...
And you were born in Uganda.
Oh, yeah. Mm. So they used to laugh about Idi Amin, like they laugh about Trump, right? Which was the biggest mistake. It was the biggest mistake. Mm. Yeah. He got the judges first. He hanged judges, then intellectuals, okay? He
Wait
systematically...
For the media. Yes.
Then the media. Mm. He systematically went for them. And this is the modern equivalent,
but
really.
But if you're right, and people will dispute it, there'll be viewers who will dispute it and say it's all going to be fine and so on. But if you are right, then creating that sense of division will work, won't it? Because this is a president who, uniquely in my experience, at his inauguration, didn't really do anything in terms of bringing the country together, which most presidents tried to do at the time of their inauguration. In other words, what has worked very well for him is defining other people, liberals within the United States, the enemy abroad. That works for Mr. Trump.
I think it works up to a certain extent, but, you know, I think he's still got major battles ahead. You know, what we've seen this week is the Constitution working. The judicial system has hit back, has reined him in, and the checks and balances are indeed working.
Including from his own Supreme Court nominee. I mean, that was quite
exactly,
astonishing,
yes.
Wasn't it? This is somebody whose appointment is controversial because of abortion and other issues, but is clearly a judge who believes in the courts being independent.
Yes, of course, there are theories about that Gorsuch knows that he needs to come out and distance himself from what Trump has done in order to win confirmation. But, you know, he's done what Supreme Court nominees have done, you know, before their confirmation hearings, was make the rounds among senators, try to allay fears, try to reassure them. Trump has denied, you know, that he has said this. You know, Gorsuch apparently told several senators that he was disheartened and found his comments disheartening and demoralizing. And I think that's essential for him to sort of distance himself in order to get win approval in the Senate. However, Trump is constantly sort of undermining that and disagreeing with him.
Interesting and shocking that the Senate and Congress have been much less effective in opposing Trump than have the judiciary, activists.
It's and a sheer numbers game. They
but
don't
I'm
have
so
the numbers.
Shocked. I'm so shocked by Paul Ryan. He resisted his own nomination quite boldly.
This is the Republican Speaker of the House.
And now he is completely a supplicant of Trump.
The issue of checks and balances, which you raise, is very, very important for me, because that's what differentiates what's happening in America and the African dictatorships I'm talking about. In Uganda, you know, we would have today the media is being hit on, people are being arrested, you know, people have rigged elections and so on. There's no way, the judiciary can't do it, you know, the media can't do it. You know, we end up perhaps fighting battles. But in America, at least, you are blessed with that, you know, the infrastructure of democracy that
I think
they'll check. Yeah, they'll check him out.
I would like to talk about his actually mobilization against Iran. You know, Obama and the other five, you know, countries, you know, permanent members of Security Council, they realize that the cost of war against Iran will be huge. It will be devastating. So he talked to the Iranian, and he actually used his pressure to reach this nuclear deal. Now he actually is trying to provoke the Iranian, and you cannot see, you know, how the Iranian now are, you know, responding. They are you know, a people of pride, and the mullahs are mobilizing this actually Trump hatred toward the Iranian to, as I said, mobilize people against the United States. Yes, I mean, you are right. And Obama actually managed to neutralize the Muslim words vis-a-vis America. America was not hated during Obama 2 terms. Now, you know, Trump is reviving this hatred among the Iranian, among the Muslim, the African, the Latin American, Muslims.
He's dialed back his rhetoric on Iran. I mean, he vowed on the campaign trail to rip up the deal with Iran, and that doesn't seem to be happening so far. So he has dialed back a bit.
Yes, he is happening because, you know, he's imposing, you know, sanctions, you know, economic sanctions against certain Iranians.
3 weeks. And also, but the shocking thing was, I was in America in October before the election. The number of Muslims who were backing Trump, shame on them, shame on them. 33% of American Muslims backed this man.
Can I just in the couple of minutes we've got left, it's a challenge the other thing he presents is a challenge for journalism. When you have got a president who basically says terrorist attacks are not being reported, they're just not being reported, and the facts are that every one of those attacks, as far as we can see, were reported and given a degree of, given different degrees of interest by different media outlets, but they were reported. How do you handle someone who says things which are clearly not the case?
Well, there's been some talk about, you know, we should not be televising live these press conferences from either Kellyanne Conway or Trump, because we need to be able to sort of fact check them, and you can't fact check them as they're happening live. It's an incredibly difficult position that journalists are in now. I mean, he's threatened them. There's you know, some question mark whether or not they'll continue to have space, the press corps in the White House. So it's very challenging. It's the constant stream of alternative facts is posing new challenges for all of us.
And also, we mustn't remember the powers behind Trump. You know, Bannon, his vice president, some of the forces, the dark forces behind him, are very well organized.
I'd be more worried about those types of forces that supported him.
Yeah, exactly.
Those very radical, sometimes armed guys and so on who were ready to do damage. You know, I would be more worried about them than Trump himself. I think that Trump will be cut short. He will be. I don't think that he can really manage to you know, intimidate totally the judiciary, even the media. I would be surprised if you people in America, you know, especially the media, is cowed like we are in our country, Uganda.
Well, let's see. Because following Western intervention in Libya, led by Britain and France, the downfall of Colonel Gaddafi has produced not one, but two Libyan governments. Now Russia has chosen sides in the Libyan conflict. And President Trump, who found time this week to criticize the US department store chain Nordstrom for dropping his daughter's clothing line, has not yet found time to criticize President Putin in any substantial way. Is this another potential victory for Russia? Maybe you could tell us what is actually going on in Libya.
You know, Gavin, 6 years ago, there was a state of euphoria on the West. We managed to achieve a huge success. You know, we toppled the tyrant. And we will make Libya as a model of success in the Middle East. 6 years, how is the situation in Libya? Nobody talks about the situation, the mess the West created in Libya. Nobody. And after
because
6 years.
It's chaotic.
It is chaotic now.
And very dangerous.
I'll tell you, yes, you have three governments, you have two parliaments, you have three armies, you have tens of militias. You have no security at all in this country. Everybody is fighting everybody. You have half of the Libyan people immigrate either to Tunisia or to Egypt, about 3 million of them, to look for safety, you know, decent way of life. Look, the situation now, okay, the West decided to support democracy, so-called democracy. The elected government never actually had their teeth or clothes in order to impose its force there. There is one general, this general called Khalifa Haftar. This Khalifa Haftar, he is ex-colonel of Libya. He used to work with Gaddafi and he was part of his Revolutionary Council. He defected, went to United States, Langley. He was actually
CIA headquarters.
He was trained and sent back to fight Gaddafi and to topple Gaddafi. And he actually tried to launch some sort of a military campaign from Chad, which is in the south of Libya. Anyway, now what is happening? This general is backed by Egypt, by United Arab Emirates, and now Russia. Why? He managed actually to secure the eastern part of Libya, which is the wealthy part.
It's where the oil
is. And he managed to root out ISIS from that eastern part. And he controlled the oil crescent, which is, you know, about 80% or 75% of Libyan oil export is coming from that part. Okay, now, the West actually couldn't do anything. They broke it in Libya. They cannot fix it.
Okay, Barry, stop. No, stop. One thing. Because you've given us the anti-Western analysis. I think it's time to look at Russia. It really is time. What Russia has done in Syria and is about to do in Libya, you have to absolutely focus.
I didn't mention Russia yet.
That's why I'm coming for you. Wait until I mention it.
Wait until I talk about Russia and then mention it now.
Mention it now.
Go to Russia.
It's very interesting what Russia is doing.
I'm explaining.
No, you can't have all the time.
Listen
tell
to
us
me.
Russia. Taking up too much time.
So, you know, the West went to Russia. Italy and Britain. They say to the Russia, please save us. We have this illegal immigration. There are 2,000 kilometers of the seashore of the Libyan territories in the Mediterranean. We cannot do anything. Please help us. Russia, Moscow, invited Haftar, and he was received by Putin, Lavrov, also the defense minister, and he had actually a very, very fruitful talk, as the media said. Okay, then they reach an agreement, first to curb all the immigration from Libya and also to work under the UN-backed government of the so-called National Accord government, and to be, you know, the leader of the army.
But
and
what does Russia get?
What does Russia get?
Russia will get a military base on Toprock in Libya.
I'll come back to you, Barry.
What's really happening is very simple. You know, you just have to study this man called Putin, and, you know. Yeah. And some of us have been in Russia. I was there for 10 years. During communist times, post-communist, and so on, we know who KGB or Putin are. This guy has succeeded in Syria, you know, making sure that the failure of the West is my gain, you know, and he's doing exactly the same template now in Libya. What he has done is identify this general Khalifa, and now what he's doing is, look, this man has the power, the military power. He's actually trying to promote him to become the real leader. Mm. The only problem is with Russia, he doesn't care the type of commotion which is. So, for example, it's the same template as in Syria. It doesn't matter whether the Syrian president is a Democrat or anything like that. If he's a stable man who can serve Russian interests, very
exactly.
good.
Exactly. But I mean, that's the point. Big problem. But if you look at it, Barry's narrative, if it's correct, you know, he's cracked down on ISIS. He will stop or try to control migration. There's a lot of people in Europe who say that's great.
No, not a lot of people in Europe, because the standards by which this man, and it isn't the country, it is this man, operates, okay, should really worry all of us. I totally agree. Intervention in Libya and what we did in Iraq, and you know how I felt about all that. But it is time now to focus on actually this really dangerous and quite evil presence in Putin. And what he did in Syria, what he has done to the people of Syria with Assad is absolutely, should be the focus of good people.
Yes,
it should be.
Look, we are not talking about Syria. We are talking about Libya. Listen, just let me talk. Just listen. Yeah, you know, we are talking, the West went to Putin. He did not go to the West. You know, they say to him, okay, come and save us in Libya. We make a mistake in Libya, please, you know, save us.
And but the West is doing that because of the migration problem, for example, to Europe.
Yeah, well, you know, President Obama said the gravest mistake, which I regret in my two terms, you know, intervention in Libya. So they admit that they made mistakes.
And he was drawn into it by the British and French, though. The British and French very proud of it at the time. Yeah. Where do you think that this leaves us? Because the argument has been 8 years of Obama, he was terrible. America withdrew on the world stage, left this vacuum. Vladimir Putin said, thank you very much. I can solve certain problems and do it brutally, but I can do it.
Right. Well, Putin wants to reestablish Russia's dominance, political and military positioning in the region. And obviously, you know, they lost billions, Russia lost billions of dollars of arms and oil contracts in Libya after Gaddafi was ousted and killed. And, you know, this is part of Putin's effort to try to reestablish his geopolitical power in the region. Now, you know, whether or not Putin backing Haftar is actually going to stem the flow of refugees is a real question to me. Isn't it going to actually undermine the stability of the country, the UN peace process, and actually leave Europe out in the cold? Because Putin doesn't care about this flow of refugees into Europe, and neither does Trump.
General Haftar has been against the UN and European attempt to curb that migration and position, you know.
But this is also where I think there is a connection between Trump and Putin. Yeah. And they both seem to admire so-called strongmen leaders, authoritarian people who they view as being able to reestablish order in where they see as chaotic regions. However, you know, Trump, he hasn't criticized Russia for this. He may not have to. He may not even have to endorse what's happening. He could just turn a blind eye and allow it to happen.
But just a few days ago, actually, General Haftar himself talked about Trump. He said that, look, because of the war we are carrying out against terrorism in this region, I think Trump will appreciate that and we can work with him. So,
Situation in Libya like that, you know, the center of power is like that. You know, you have a government in Tripoli, and this government is backed by Muslim Brotherhoods and also supported by Qatar and Turkey. And you have the UN-backed government, which has no power on the ground at all. Now, the Muslim Brotherhood-supported government is about to set up a new army. You know, they call it the National Guards, and in order to consolidate its power on the West. The problem is now what we are facing. Haftar is a very clever man, despite I hate him personally because of the Langley things a long time ago, because of my leftist way of thinking. Anyway, so what's he doing? He used the immigration card to put pressure on the West, on Britain, Italy, France, and the United States, saying, look, okay, you ignore me, you don't recognize my services, my power, I will use this immigration card against you. And he used it very well. After 6 years, they say, they throw the towel, saying, please come and help us.
We're going to have to leave it there. That's it for Dateline London for this week. You can comment on the program on Twitter at Gavin Essler. You can engage with our guests. We're back next week at the same time. Please make a date with Dateline London. Bye-bye.